Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Two-Placed Heart by Doan Phuong Nguyen, narrated by VyVy Nguyen. Prologue. Nashville, 1996, present day. Worlds apart. My dresser is a sea of notebooks, all shapes, colors, and designs. The pages scribbled with my messy handwriting, stories I've created within its lines. Books litter my bedroom floor, piles and piles of novels that I've read. My library books stacked high, always growing taller. Entire worlds yet to be discovered. My sister, Buh, her side of the room is clean, tidy, everything in its place. The opposite of mine. Buzz's dinosaur and science books are tucked neatly away on her bookshelf. Colorful crystal geodes adorn her side of the room. Her two hamsters in their cage, always spinning. My nose is always absorbing words, my imagination running free. I am the sun, and she is Neptune, the farthest planet in our solar system. We don't even look the same, like we're not related at all. My face is round and pinchable. Vietnamese aunties at church are always squeezing my cheeks until it hurts, ooing at how adorable I am. Buzz's face is thinner, long and lean like Baz. My long hair flows down my back. Buzz's hair curls cutely below her chin. I have round glasses that the kids at school make fun of. My sister's eyes are perfect, but when she smiles, she's missing her two front teeth. I used to tell her we found her in the dumpster and adopted her. She believed me until my parents found out. I got in big trouble. Sometimes I think we are like the plus and minus sides of a magnet. Eventually, we'll attract. But last night, Ba asks me, "Why must Ba always talk about Vietnam? Why do we have to speak Vietnamese at home when talking in English is so much easier? I wish he'd stop pushing his country on us." "It's our country too," I say. "We're người Việt." "I'm not," Ba says. "I'm American, and you are too." Her words are a dagger in my stomach because what if she's right? Forgetting. When Ba and I speak to each other, it's always in English. We don't even think about it. We just do. With our parents, it's always Vietnamese, even if it's broken. English mixed with Tiếng Việt. Ma doesn't understand the English words we use. Even after 5 years in America, her English is weak. She has to ask Ba, "What are they saying?" Ba has to translate, then scolds us. "Vietnamese only at home," a sentence he said like a million times. He doesn't know how hard it is to only use Vietnamese words. Sometimes when I forget a word, it's like I never knew it at all. Every day, my Tiếng Việt disappears a little at a time, like there's an amoeba inside my brain, stealing one word at a time. The guilt gnaws as the amoeba steals more than just my words. Because what kind of person doesn't know their own language? So at night, I steal like the amoeba. I take Ma and Ba's huge English to Vietnamese dictionary, clutch it to my chest, and hide underneath my covers with a flashlight, and look up the words that are slowly disappearing from my mind. The Từ Điển An Việt has thousands of pages, too many words, translations swimming in small print. I close the dictionary, overwhelmed. How will I ever relearn all these words? What if my Tiếng Việt is gone forever? Losing everything. The next morning, Ba picks up the dictionary, says to me, "Why do you care so much? So what if we forget Viet words? It's not like we ever use it except with ma and ba." I shake my head at her. Wish I could get my baby sister to understand. Losing our words, our language, feels like we are losing everything. A past life, a culture that flows through our veins, who we are, and who we were meant to be. I don't understand why it doesn't matter to her, why this big part of us means nothing. My sister doesn't struggle, doesn't feel divided between two places. She fits in at school, has lots of friends, is always happy, never nervous or worried like me. The horns on her forehead, markings from the accident in Vietnam, may have disappeared. But when she speaks words like these, I think, a devil still lives inside my little sister. The photos from Vietnam. Ban Ngoại, my mother's mother, mails us an updated family photo. Ma's sisters, brothers, my first cousins surround my grandmother, who is sitting down, too thin and frail, looking weary, more tired than I've ever seen her. Ban Ngoại is sick, Ma says. Her heart is weak. She may not be with us for much longer. My eyes fill with tears. How can my grandmother die without us there? How can the world continue to spin without her in it? I stare at the photo in my hand. I don't remember her, Ba says, with no emotion, and walks away. I wonder, when did my sister become an alien from outer space? I remember another photo, the one we took before we left for America, our entire family, full and complete. In this photo, they are complete without us. I stare at the unfamiliar faces of my cousins. Once, a long time ago, they were my baby chickens, following me everywhere. Now they are strangers, thin beanstalks with black hair like mine, our shared flat nose, big ears that stick out. But when I look down at my own body, pinch my tummy fat, it does not look like their thin bodies. I am round and a little pudgy. When did my body become more American, too? The typewriter. Ba has an old typewriter. It is heavy, black steel, the most magical thing in our house. The click, click, click as the paper is rolled and loaded reminds me of a faded memory of when I was little in Vietnam and Ba still translated books. The clickety-clack of each key as it's pressed, the smell of ink. I watch Ba as he uses this new typewriter, marvel as each letter marks ink on the paper, the words that come alive. When my parents are asleep, I go to the living room, where it's kept, load the paper like I've seen Ba do, type out a story inside me, screaming to come out. Super Phuong, half bird, half human. She can fly at the speed of light. She flies to Vietnam, saves a burning village. Oh no, the villagers cry. The water you used to put out the fire was infested with a brain-eating amoeba. We're all infected. I type and type without stopping. The letters flow. The words come out. Sentences become paragraphs. It is magic. Words making story come to life. Head in the clouds. I'm going to be a writer when I grow up, I tell my parents.
Your head is always in the clouds, Ba says.
Writing will not make any money, Ma says.
We did not come to America for you to become a pauper.
I'm going to be a scientist,
Ba tells my parents. Why can't you be more like your sister? Ma asks me.
Study hard. Go to college. Become a doctor, engineer, or scientist. Jobs to make money, so you can have a good life.
My friends at Vietnamese church do not have dreams like I do. They will do what makes their parents happy. My friend T says she's going to be a nurse, and Lan says she's going to be a college professor. They do not struggle with the sinking worry that their Vietnamese-ness is disappearing day by day by... They never mix English words with Vietnamese words when speaking to their parents. They still remember who they are, fully Viet, whole and complete. I'm not like them. I'm not like Ba either, the American. Who am I? Alone. I'm always alone at school. I used to have a best friend, Amanda. She doesn't talk to me now, not after her parents got divorced. We once shared secrets, told each other everything. Now she spends her time with the cool white girls who wear too much makeup, dress like they're 18 instead of 12. Ma doesn't let me wear makeup, says it makes your skin old. I keep my head down in my books, escaping to imaginary lands. I tell kids in my class to call me Dawn. Like the dawn, I say, make a gesture for the rising sun. I ignore the other part of my name, the harder, embarrassing Phuong. Sometimes, I tell them, I'm Zoe, named after the baby sister of Hanson, a band I really like. I want to be anyone else, someone who isn't ashamed or confused about who she is. Sometimes, in the middle of the night, when my family is sleeping, I'll cake my face with Ma's makeup, smear the powder all over it, just to see what I'd look like if I were the color of pale. Paris by night. Every night, after homework and dinner, my parents sit Ba and me down between our couch and the TV, pop in a VHS tape. Paris by night. In this Vietnamese variety show, singers belt out sentimental ballads about our lost homeland. Actors do funny skits, sometimes set in Vietnam, sometimes in America. No English is spoken. I watch the show. Scenes depicting our old country tug at me. The missing is still there. My sister hates watching Paris by night. The missing of a quê hương, homeland, is something foreign to her.
I wish you'd stop pushing Vietnam on us.
Ba crosses her arms and pouts.
We live in America now.
Ba's eyes turn very sad.
Vietnam will always be part of who we are, he says.
Who we are.
Vietnam is not part of who I am, Ba tells me that night. How can it be part of me when I don't remember it? Not any of it.
I hear her turn away, shuffle in her comforter. As I listen for her snores, because my sister snores like a hog, my fingers start to itch, itching to type, to feel the cool keys of the typewriter on my skin, the sound of that familiar clickety-clack. Tonight, as I tiptoe out of bed toward Ba's typewriter, the words inside me that bubble up aren't my imaginary worlds, but something even more important. I have to vanquish the amoeba inside my head. My little sister needs to know our family history, the lives of those who came before, typed out and written for us to always remember, so that if my memories disappear, I will never forget. What if?
Identity, the dictionary defines, who a person is. What if you are a mashup, divided in two? A girl with one foot here, another there. What if you are more than what they see? Not Vietnamese, not American, a fuzzy place in between, never quite belonging, a girl trapped in time. The past bleeds into the present, shapes our future. But to know who we are, we have to look back. Back to the beginning. Vietnam, 1975 to 1991. Part 1. A fishbone in their throats. 1975. Little sister, our story. Why we are here and not there begins and ends with Ba. Before we were born, our father was a spy, a first lieutenant, an intelligence officer for the Republic of Vietnam, a country that stopped existing, erased forever when the North Vietnamese communists won the war in 1975. But in the hearts of its patriots, who fought for freedom and lost, the Republic of Vietnam, its yellow flag with three red stripes, will never, ever be forgotten. Like Stalin, four decades before and a world away, the Viet Cong communists in power rounded up, locked up all former officers from the losing side, imprisoned them in re-education camps throughout the jungles of South and North Vietnam. No trials, no justice, no escape, only concentrated indoctrination. Our father, the spy, was dangerous, the troublemaker of the camp, a fishbone in the throat of his enemy, the one they could not break. The war was over, but revolution burned hot and red in his veins, an eternal ember for the country that once was. Friends become enemies. Since we were little, Ba has warned us, only your family is to be trusted wholly. They will never leave you. Friends should only be believed 50%. They will come and go. You never know who will betray you. Believe them too much, and they will stab you in the back when your face is turned. Do you know why Ba is so wary, little sister? Here is why. Here is why. Ba remembers the day his friends became his enemies, when he was betrayed by those he most trusted. March 1975, a month before Saigon fell and the Vietnam War ended, the Viet Cong had defeated the South Vietnamese troops in Quang Ngai, a city in central Vietnam. The communists ordered the defeated troops to turn themselves in for re-education. They claimed it would be for only 3 days. All lies, Ba would tell me later. Many prisoners were locked up for weeks, which cascaded into years, then decades. Some were locked away for almost 20. Over 1 million people were imprisoned in the re-education camps. Some 165,000 people died from camp conditions, malnourishment, and illness. Others were killed at the hands of their captors. The Viet Cong set up checkpoints all around Quang Ngai to try to capture their enemy. Ba was stopped in the Sơn Tịnh district, a neighbor district to Quang Ngai to the north, wearing civilian clothing, no uniform, no boots. The communists were suspicious. Ba had a southern accent. Are you Republic of Vietnam? They asked. I'm a high school teacher, Ba answered. They narrowed their eyes, examined his feet to see if he had calluses from wearing boots. But our father was a spy. He never wore boots like a regular soldier. They detained Ba, but did not shackle him like the others. That afternoon, the Viet Cong made those arrested walk to their headquarters in the mountains, where Ba was questioned once again. "I am a teacher," Ba said again. They released him. "Go home and teach." Ba did not go back to the safe house where he had been staying to do his intelligence work. Instead, he went down the road, slept under a tree at night, kept walking until he reached the heart of Quang Ngai. Ba, always brave and true to his cause, had orders. Report back to Saigon the number of South Vietnamese soldiers turning themselves in to the Viet Cong. Ba ran into Captain Trâm, the head of another intelligence unit. The captain said, "Why are you here? I told the Viet Cong that you had been shot dead, but your captain has betrayed you. He leads the Viet Cong in search of you now." Then Ba's captain appeared, like a Judas kissing Jesus on the cheek.
"Hoàng, where have you been these days? We've been looking for you."
Ba did not answer, and immediately behind the Judas, a Viet Cong appeared. The Judas said to the Viet Cong,
"I told you, if you follow Trâm, you would find Hoàng."
The Viet Cong said to Ba,
"Hello, Hoàng, where have you been? It's many days since we have seen you. Where have you been living?"
Ba shrugged his shoulders in disgust.
"I stay everywhere,"
Viet Cong said.
"Then you will stay with me tonight at my home."
Ba knew then that he'd been caught, betrayed by his captain, a former friend turned enemy. The next day, he was taken to be re-educated. So be wary, little sister, of anyone who calls themselves friend. The worst is behind us. For 7 years, the Viet Cong tried to break Ba, but his mind was strong, determined. He would not be re-educated, refused to accept the communist ways. One time, he told me they caged him in a dark cell, solitary confinement for one whole month. No window, no light, no one to talk to. Just empty walls holding their secrets of a bloody past. Feet shackled with iron, fed only one bowl of rice every day. When his confinement was over, he couldn't walk, but his will was strong. Ba was unbreakable. They could not brainwash or indoctrinate him. He's stubborn like you, little sister. Each day they asked him,
"Do you work for the Pentagon? Do you work for the Americans?"
Ba said,
"I don't know what the Pentagon is."
His answers angered his jailers.
"A black crow will always be a black crow."
Sometimes they tortured him, but they couldn't kill him, afraid he would be the prison martyr. Once he caught malaria, almost died, but his younger sister, Arco Batan, traipsed through the dangerous forests to get to the prison, just to sneak him medicine. Do you think you and I could ever be brave like that, Ba? Would you brave through dangerous lands to save me? The last to be released from the camp, our father was handed a paper of house detention, not release papers. Every day, he had to record his daily activities in a booklet, and once a week, report to the officials. If there was any sign of revolution, he would be arrested again. Ba, the revolutionary, was free to leave prison, but not truly free. A Place to Call Home. Summer, 1982. Ba returned home 7 years after the war ended, starved, tortured, beaten, but spirit unbroken. Home to a country devastated, recovering. Home to a family scattered, divided by ashes and the Pacific Ocean. Ba's father lay murdered in the cold earth, hidden in a spot only the Viet Cong knew. His grandfather buried 5 of 9 children before heartbreak and shock took him to the ancestors 1 year before Ba returned home. Ba's Aunt Seven fled to America the same year, joining her sister, Aunt Ten, who escaped by boat in 1975, losing her 2 children in the chaos. Ba returned home with nothing, only a spirit determined to survive. The Black Frenchman's House. The echoes of the past haunted Ba as he came home to live in the front room of his grandfather's house. Ba's paternal grandfather, our great-grandfather, our uncle, was a rich man. The villagers called him the Black Frenchman. His
skin was. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.